And she mentions Giulio Andreotti, who has been in and out of government for a long time, so on, and has, she says, there has virtually been no scandal in Italy's post-war history in which Andreotti has had no role. At the very least, even if not directly implicated, he happened to be in charge of the ministry in whose area of responsibility are given scandals occurred. I don't want to get into trouble at this particular point. That's what she says about it. In summary, it might be an overstatement to argue that the P2 affair and the other scandals which we have mentioned above are the inevitable consequence of an imperfect political and economic system. A vast array of historical, political, institutional, and cultural factors coalesced to make Italy, by comparison to other Western parliamentary democracies, a flawed democracy. Overall, the institutional structures of the Italian political system are basically similar to those of other Western parliamentary democracies. It is rather in the functioning of the institutions of parliamentary democracy and, above all, the nature and role of the political parties that the unique features of the Italian political system become evident. By comparison to other Western democracy, Italy is often represented as an extreme example of political instability. Then she goes and talks about the number of governments, which says over 45. Behind this facade of instability, however, Italy can be seen paradoxically as the most stable of Western democracies. As noted above, a single party has dominated Italian politics. And this is also true of the political personnel, she argues. The long-term stability of party rule and of political leadership is in turn reinforced by an equally remarkable pattern of electoral stability. This is obviously before the last election. How can these unique characteristics of Italian democracy be explained? The answer lies above all in the weakness of formal institutions and the concentration of real power in the hands of the political parties, creating what the Italians call partitocrazia, or rule by party. When political parties clearly play a central role in any Western democracy, ordinarily government, once in place, have a certain autonomy from the party organization which is sustaining them. In Italy, on the contrary, real power lies not with the prime minister, but rather with the leadership of the parties making up the governing coalition. The key to understanding Italy's flawed democracy thus lies in the nature of the political parties and the party system. Because of the fragmentation of the Italian party system and the ideological differentiation among the parties, Italian governments tend to be congenitally weak, reduced to immobility by guerrilla warfare among the erstwhile allies. Partitocrazia goes beyond domination of parliament and the executive by the political parties to embrace a broad cross-section of the economic, social, and cultural life of the country. Virtually no section of Italian life is free from party interference. The boards of directors of a far-reaching network of public and semi-public agencies, including banks, state-owned agencies, hospitals, social security, and health insurance programs, radio and television, are subject to government, that is, party nomination. Thus, the Italian state and the Italian society have been colonized by the political parties, creating a vast spoil system in which levers of power are strictly apportioned according to the electoral weight of the various parties, including, since the mid-1970s, even the communists. This system of sottogoverno constitutes a reservoir of partisan power and patronage without equal in any other Western democracy. The basis for the creation of such a system of power has been the tremendous expansion of state intervention in the post-war period, the progressive interpretation of the governing interpenetration of the governing parties, especially the compete with the state administration, and the consequent privatization of state power for political ends. In Italy, power has come to signify, above all, access to patronage, and patronage further reinforces entrenched power for individual politicians and factions as much or more, or more so than any given party as a whole. The dysfunctions of Italy's vast bureaucracy also provide a fertile terrain for political maneuver of both the illicit and illicit variety. individual politicians have constructed political fortunes through their privileged access to key sectors of the bureaucracy and their ability to use their political connections to produce results which might otherwise require months or years. Therefore, financial scandals like those associated with Michele Sindona and Roberto Calvi, as well as broader phenomena like the mafia and the Tudor, should not be viewed as criminal activities distinct from and directed against the legitimate institutions of Italian democracy, but rather as an integral part of the existing system of power. Italy's flawed model of parliamentary democracy, the degeneration of the party system into sterile, bickering over positions of power and patronage, increasingly divorced from the real problems of the country, and the consequent paralysis of formal institutions, has created a void of effective decision-making power into which so-called occult powers have stepped. In addition, the colonization of the state and broad sectors of society by the political parties and the resulting logic of locizzazione and patronage as the heart of the political struggle have resulted in a blurring of the lines between public and private, and in a pervasive conception of the state as, above all, a vehicle for personal and factional interest. That, I think, is the heart of the paper, and I'll leave room for the commentator. Thank you.
Thank you, Spencer. The commentator is Elisa Carillo, or Carillo, if we check on the origin of the name, and she is a professor of history at the Marymount College in Tarrytown, New York, and among other works, she has produced a biography on Alcide De Gasperi, which I was told was very interesting, but I didn't have a chance to look at it. Yes. And actually, she's having she's published many articles on the Christian Democratic Party in Italy and on Italian Catholicism. And presently, she's doing a research on women in Christian democracy. Elisa.
Thank you. Thank you. Before I begin my comments, I would like to thank Spencer Scala and his associates, especially Jack Hughes and Luciana Pelicano, for having organized this conference. Having organized symposia on a regional level myself, I know the problems involved. And this particular symposium, an international symposium, has had more than its share of inconvenience. Can you hear me? But Spencer's flexibility and his tenacity has ensured the extraordinary success of this symposium. We've had 2.5 days of brilliant, stimulating papers. And I'm sure that we will all go home feeling grateful that we were privileged to be part of these proceedings. So thank you, Spencer. The paper of Professors Judith Chubb and Maurizio Vanitelli is very timely, providing as it does excellent background material for understanding the current political crisis. This crisis has been evolving, of course, over decades. Many factors enter into it, not the least scandals. Taking three episodes of the 1980s, the mafia assassination of General Carlo Alberto Dalla Chiesa in Palermo, the mysterious suicide of the financier Roberto Calvi under Blackfriars Bridge in London, and the equally unsuicidal suicide by poison in prison of another notorious financier, Michele Sindona, the authors portray these events as epitomizing the corruption and violence that characterized the power struggle in Italy. Professors Chubb and Vanicelli also concern themselves with mafia penetration of the political process and with the attempt of the Khufu Masonic Lodge to substitute its power for that of the state. The precise role of the political parties in these scandals is not discussed, but the authors quite clearly hold the parties responsible for the major defects of Italian society and government. Professors Chubb and Vanicelli conclude that scandals such as those they have described are unlike scandals in other democracies because they are interconnected and they are symptomatic of structural flaws in Italian democracy. While one can agree that the Dalla Chiesa, Calvi, and Sindona affairs reflect corruption and violence at the highest levels of Italian life, and that rule by party has been a fact of life in Italy, other generalizations or positions of the authors are somewhat more difficult to accept or to substantiate. They state, for example, that, quote, the majority of Italian scandals seem to leave few, if any, traces. In most cases, as soon as the immediate uproar caused by the scandal has subsided, a business-as-usual attitude gains the upper hand, unquote. Although this allegation may have some merit for the past, so even for the past I have reservations here, the allegation certainly does not hold up today. Scandals are no longer ignored or tolerated. If one may judge from the current wave of arrests of prominent politicians and businessmen, the resignations of cabinet members, and the strong support given by the general public to what has become known as Operation Clean Hands, practically all the political parties have been implicated in kickback scandals, which have involved bribes to politicians for government contracts for everything from the presidencies of state agencies to cleaning crews for hospitals and airports. During recent weeks alone, three cabinet ministers have resigned. The leaders of three parties have resigned. Foxy from the Socialist Party, La Malfa, the Republican Party, and Altissimo from the Liberal Party. The head of ENI, the gigantic state-owned energy agency, has been arrested. And the list goes on and on. The resignations would not have been proffered if a whitewash had been anticipated. The office of the paper complained that there has been, quote, no alternation of power in the 40 years since the establishment of the Republic in 1946, unquote. But alternation depends on the will of the electorate, and for whatever reason or reasons, the electorate has chosen to give the Christian Democratic Party a plurality of votes. In the recent parliamentary elections, the plurality reached its lowest point, and it will probably continue to decline. Professors Chubb and Vanicelli conclude that past scandals reflect structural flaws in Italian democracy. In my opinion, however, their call for a profound transformation of the parties and their relationship with the public is unrealistic. There is also the danger in crippling the old parties that new parties, for example, the Lombard League, may come to power with programs calling for separatism and hatred of the foreigner. I think that there is room for optimism for the future. I don't think that structural changes are necessary. I think that defects in the Constitution and in the political process can be remedied. but I have often been accused of being an optimist, and perhaps if I lived in Italy, I would feel differently. Let me list some of the developments of the past year that give me cause for optimism. First, while not tampering with Italy's basic social welfare system, the Amato government has succeeded in obtaining an austerity budget for the first time in decades. And this budget makes a real attempt at self-discipline. The reduction of the cabinet from 30 to 24 members would seem to reduce somewhat the swollen government bureaucracy and the concomitant opportunities for political patronage. Secondly, tough measures against organized crime and especially the mafia have been adopted. These give more power to the police and to judges. The assassination of the top Sicilian magistrates, Falcone and Borsellino, in May and July of last year, incensed Italians in general and not merely the Sicilians. Thirdly, steps have been initiated to privatize the enormous state holdings, Erie, Eni, etc. These represent a far larger share of the national economy than anything comparable in any other country of the European community. And more importantly, these state holdings constitute juicy plums for thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of political employees. Fourthly, the system of proportional representation, which has created to date some 62 unstable governments, coalition governments, this system will probably be modified. When instituted almost 50 years ago, the system, in a reaction against fascism, was designed to give expression to as many political opinions as possible. The result, however, as Professors Chubb and Vanicelli rightly point out, has been political gridlock, coalition government based not so much on shared values as on a distribution of patronage, and the avoidance of accountability. I might add that in 1948, Giuseppe Dossetti, who was one of the leaders of the left wing of the Christian Democratic Party, argued against coalition governments because he said that coalition governments would mean the avoidance of responsibility, of accountability. But De Gasperi, on the other hand, was insistent on a coalition government. This was after the 1948 elections, because he saw this as a way of containing the integralism that he saw in certain members of the Christian Democratic Party, including Gasperi. Fifthly, and finally, and this is the cause for my greatest optimism concerning the future, there seems to be a revival of civic consciousness among Italians. Perhaps many Italians were willing to put up with corruption in the government when a communist threat was perceived. But with the erosion of this threat, they no longer see their personal fates tied to the traditional political parties, to dishonesty, corruption, and violence. The average Italian is now saying, basta. Thank you.
Thank you, Elisa, for your comments. And now we are having a work, a paper from Gino Giugni, who is an extremely well-known Senator of the Republic, and he is also President of the Labor Commission of the Senate, the Italian Senate. He is, among other things, the father of the Statute of the Worker, which was a milestone in Italian social politics. And actually, he is not only the best jurist in the Socialist Party, but he is also the president of the Italian Socialist Party. Gino Giugni.
Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me to join this symposium. Thank you also for avoiding giving me the role of drawing conclusions. This is a report like the other report. My task is, everybody thinks this task is very difficult, and it is the most difficult. As a matter of fact, I think you will accept the definition as a rather hard task, because what I'm trying to answer is the question as to whether the Italian Socialist Party, or Italian Socialism, of which we are celebrating the 100th birthday, if, as to whether this party in Italy will have a future. And I can already advance to the conclusion, which will be very problematic. The pessimism of reason as opposed to the optimism of will. The two conclusions will be conflicting, and only future events will say who will win the conflict. I think, anyhow, that we have the necessity to extend our analysis from the history of the Italian Socialism to a wider frame, a wider geographical frame, namely to put the problem into the Western European context. Second, also a political frame. We shall have to connect the problems of the Italian Socialist Party with the problems of social democracy in Western Europe, and even more with the problems of the left. I get immediately to the comparison between left and socialism. My basic assumption at the beginning is that up to 1989, up to the collapse of the Berlin Wall, a correspondence between the left and democratic socialism in Western Europe was almost complete. Throughout the second half of the 20th century, the area of the left in Europe had been the prevailing domain of socialist movements in their manifold varieties. Towards the end of the century, 20th century, an epical event had taken place, namely the end of the communist schism. To that we may add the gradual impoverishment of the 1968-born leftist gothism, notably in its Marxian component. The conclusion is that at the end of 1989, the area of the left in Europe was covered in a uniform and almost a demonic way by democratic socialism or social democracy. The only challenge, though a marginal one with reference to social democracy as a whole, we shall deal with the Italian case later on, was offered by the Green Parties and by the social and opinion movements or single issue movement. But it was not a dangerous challenge. Of course, on a world scale, the outlook was less clear-cut. Anyhow, within the area of the free and democratic West, the only exception to social democratic hegemony over the left occurred in the United States, an exception whose reasons and roots had been digged and explored for decades. All that happened 3 years ago. 3 years after the demolition of the wall, social democratic hegemony is faced with a hard challenge, and the danger of a collapse should not be underestimated. According to a recently revived opinion, the area of the left might replace the socialist league with that of a democratic or radical reformist movements. Radical or reformist movements with no permanent class settlement and with a secondary appeal given to social issues, be rather committed on the old arena of the civil rights and on the newer one of environmental problems. It's worth mentioning now the Big Bang by Mr. Rocard, but I think it might be a little misleading, because if one reads carefully the famous, or already become famous, speech of Tour, one can see that Mr. Rocard is not speaking of the end of socialism, but of the refoundation of socialism. Of course, this possible replacement of socialism with the democratic rule over the left recalls a similarity with American liberalism, American liberal movements, and it is often evoked. And it would be an easy prophecy to assert that this assumption will receive a new impetus from Mr. Clinton's trial. Social democracy, in its present meaning, draws its identity mainly from socialist reformism as opposed to revolutionary socialism. A reformist version of socialism has long been prevailing within the social democratic area since the revolutionary expectations collapsed. But the socialist reformism itself, in its long history, has taken many different forms, and even the use of the word is not uniform. We can say that it is widely accepted, which for Italy is something which turns back to 10 years ago, not more than 10 years ago, because in the 70s, during the 70s and before, the term reformism in the socialist circles was considered more or less as a blaspheme. I summarized the three different versions of socialist reformism. First, the classic variety of reformism of Marxian derivation, mainly Falaschi, and the self-defining in contrast with the revolutionary strategy. Well, in Italy, we might have Ugo Guido Mondolfo, Saverio Merlino, the early Saragat. This variety of reformism considers the reforms as a step towards the creation of a new society. It is in opposition to petty or piecemeal reformism and advocates structural reform. This more piecemeal reformism refers mainly to social legislation, often considered of low profile as compared with the more ambitious strategic goals of structural reforms affecting the economic system as a whole. The achievement of the welfare state itself was underestimated, notwithstanding its being the achievement now acknowledged as the sort of identity card of social democracy. The late expression of this time of structural reformism may be found in the common program of the PS in France and the Communist Party in France, or in the so-called revolutionary reformism. Can mention Riccardo Lombardi in Italy, he must be in France. The second version, trade-off reformism, connected with political patronage, which never became a doctrine, but was largely practiced by socialist parties, especially when and where they either exerted or shared power. It belongs to the category of practical opportunism, which had been recalled this morning. Third version, reforms conceived as tools and targets to spur the masses. Changes are not an end in themselves, but rather a means to trigger off and support social movements, thus providing them with a political outlet. In Italy, this is more or less the version of reformism which was underscored by the socialist left and the communist left as well. Thank you. Inga, for instance. The left which is privileging mass action over governmental action. Some time ago, I had the task of working out a cross-examination of the official programs of the parties of the Socialist International. And a cross-examination of the common values and goals as identified by these official programs points out a common finding which deserves an absolute priority. That is to say, the dropout of socialism conceived as a road towards a new society, a realm of utopia, or to put it more gently and softly, a new but predictable structure of society. This idea of a new society, of a long-range program, of the possible prediction of a different structure of a society, this idea of this constructive idea is not only covered by the socialist doctrine, it belongs more or less to the whole area of leftist philosophies, especially during the past century. On the contrary, socialism as a new society, as an ultimate end, or even as the end of history, is over. It has been replaced by the idea of progress as a process of trials and errors. Pragmatism, experimentalism, and an open society won the match. Popper replaced Karl Marx. As far as spiritual roots are concerned, for instance, the German Social Democratic Program mentions, in a very syncretist way, Christendom, humanist philosophy, the Enlightenment, Marx's historical and sociological doctrine, the experience of the workers' movement and the women's liberation. But this syncretistic philosophy is common to all, and one may wonder, I insist upon this point, whether a difference still exists with American liberalism. I insist upon the question to state that the question itself does not make much sense, because socialism is as European as liberalism in its new future, new frontier, and so on, Clinton's version. It is America. After 100 years, we have been witnessing the triumph of revisionism by Edward Bernstein, joined to cabin approach. And we have made a step further. even the definition of liberal socialism in Europe is now enjoying a mounting success. But if there is no such ultimate end, the common ground lies in the common values. The differenza specifica, beyond the generally accepted values of freedom and democracy, seems to be solidarity and equality. These values, obviously, have more appeal in the countries where they are opposed to a revival of Darwinist individualism. But equality is no longer conceived as uniformity, but as equal opportunities. In the German program, Selbstbehauptung. In turn, solidarity generates loyalty to the social or welfare state, but with two important developments. First, the welfare state must be built upon the readiness of the stronger layer to share in with the weaker, but without worsening its standard of living, therefore remaining strong. Neither impoverishment nor austerity would belong to the socialist way of life. The second is that the state should provide guidance to individual and all group self-help, instead of relieving them of responsibility from themselves. Emancipation through collective self-help and action is still the hardcore of the socialist method. It is a remainder like this along 100 years. But collective action is more and more conceived as the threshold of individual initiative and responsiveness. And its appeal is no longer restricted to working men. Rather, it goes to groups or layers of a population under a condition of exclusion. Working men are no longer the excluded class. The stronger appeal is to new layers like women, migrants, race minorities, and so on. This can be read, cross-read, in all the programs of the socialist parties. As we go through the specific demands listed in the rather lengthy program, we find, for instance, that the traditional demands, such as worker participation, seem to have lost priority, while the cognate idea of economic democracy often seems to be a container of vagueness. It is better defined in the Swedish program. The German Social Democratic Party doesn't seem to go far beyond the Mitbestimmung or co-determination. The Italian Socialist Party beyond the practice of collective bargaining. On the contrary, there has been an unforeseeable reversal in the hierarchy to topics, and prominence has been gained by the issues relating to civil, political, and social rights. If the conversion to market economy philosophy is complete, some basic ideas as public spending in a Keynesian policy still hold on, even though they are alternated, especially in governmental practice, with restrictive practices against inflationary pressures. And the same applies to public property, no longer treated as a document, but still as a workable tool aimed at improving the environmental context of the market economy itself. Nationalization is no longer the mythical aim it used to be in the socialist program. A new aspect instead lies in the social basis of socialist movement, which is sought after everywhere, far beyond the boundaries of the working class, with keen attention being paid to consumers and the self-employed. Even the philosophy the socialist philosophy lost its work-centered and production-centered character. Social democracy, furthermore, is no longer the political arm of the trade unions, as it had been defined until recently. As a matter of fact, trade unions are still powerful political agencies in some countries, like Italy or the United Kingdom, but nowhere they are the main support of social democratic parties. The new but intense, the social democratic parties are everywhere, multi-class, opinion parties, and even catch-all parties. And the new but intense attention being paid to ecology, or more recently also to bioethics, calls for a social consensus widely larger than that of yet achievable through wage earners. Or anyway, to a permanent alliance among social classes. If this is a, well, we can cut something. It's point six in the paper. The present crisis of the socialist parties in Western Europe may be a symptom of an historical decline, but to answer the question as to whether they would be replaced by left democratic movements or set aside also by a possible, not impossible, revival of revolutionary expectations is for the time being more a matter for prophecy than for rational prediction. We should beware of a superficial or oversimplified analysis and conclusions. It should be emphasized that in recent decades, most socialist parties had been called to rule their countries and local governments, which are also foremost important, and that the exercise of power usually displays a corrosive effect. A loss of electoral appeal in Spain, Sweden, or Greece, and also in France, where the prospects might be worse, seems to be a physiological reality. One today could hardly state, on the contrary, that this decline is affecting the Social Democratic Party of Germany, or even the Labour Party. The latter, although has been out of power for almost 15 years after suffering from splits and defeats, it still exerts an intelligent leadership of the opposition. Historical decline or temporary setback, preservation of identity or confluence into a larger democratic left, all of these dilemmas at present cannot find an answer which would not be written in water. The appeal to the teachings of experience show rather that social democracy or liberal socialism in Western Europe maintains a dominant role within the left, and sometimes is still identifiable with the left itself. The case of Italian socialism is the most dramatic. The forecast of a possible historical decline should here be integrated by the more drastic one of a possible collapse, affecting at least its older branch, the Italian Socialist Party, the branch entitled to claim the heritage of the foundation. But not even relieving the heir of the Communist Party, now transformed, as you know, into the Democratic Party of the left. Much weaker, uncertain, divided, as compared with the old Communist Party. The PSI's breakdown shows to be the effect of the unfortunate combination of many factors, like the secondary role played within the left since the fall of fascism, and I can stand back to the report by Luciano Pellicana, which was balanced only by the practice of power allotment, masterly carried on by the former leader, Mr. Craxi, through the use of an unbiased power of interdiction or power of coalition, based upon a strictly proportional representation system. But the breakdown of Craxi's personal charismatic leadership following the impact of a defeat in the 1992 elections and later the explosion of the moral question involving Mr. Craxi himself. The judicial extensive prosecution of bribery and corruption, which is leading to a breakdown of the whole political system, but hit more strongly the PSI and its ruling group, Papo and middle leadership. Because the fall of the bias against the Communist Party, the interdiction against the Communist Party, now PDS, and the consequent withering away of the strategy based upon the power of coalition. The loss of creative initiative in political action with the practical waiver within the PSI to proposals endowed with a potential strong appeal, like the one of a presidential republic. The arrogant rejection of the referendums on electoral reform, which greatly appealed instead to public opinion. And last but not least, the stubborn opposition or attitude of lawlessness vis-à-vis the process of change taking place in the Communist Party after 1989, and next to that, in the all too likely perspective of a modification of the electoral system from proportional representation to single member constituencies, could no longer stand. Taking the former Communist Party, now Democratic Left Party, as part of the socialist area, one finds a situation which could hardly be regarded as much healthier. The moral question hit the party too, although with a remarkably minor intensity. The imperative choice between a government program to endorse and a policy inspired by primary concern with mass action is unfortunately taken through the method of continuous postponement. The growing competition of the reborn Communist Party, or Rifondazione Comunista, and other leftist groupings strengthened this practice of wait and see. Its electoral appeal is running around a mere 15%. The search for a new set of principles shows a deep cleavage, partly generationally, between socialists and democrats, and especially imbued with the Americanism and now fans of Clinton and Clintonism. To some extent, the latter choice, which might be a healthy one, as far as the relations with the PSI causes are concerned, is taken subrepticiously as a way to bypass and overcome the problem of unity between the two parties who originated from the same fatherland just 100 years ago and whose members still address one another as comrades. No wonder, therefore, that Rocard's appeal to a rebirth of the left, endowed with a wider philosophical and electoral coverage than the traditional socialist one, raised much interest. The point is that what for other socialist movements might be a matter for even a lengthy debate, in the present state of the Italian socialist, deserves immediate and prompt answer. Either the party in strict cooperation with its historical name is reborn to a new youth, or what is left of its immense historical wealth will have to be delivered to a non-socialist left. To relieve our pain in conclusion, we observe that perhaps the dilemma is just a formal and procedural one. All socialist parties are already imbued with left democratic principles, whereas the latter parties, where they exist, do not mark a deep difference with the socialist or social democratic party. They do not mark a deep difference if we do not consider birth, tradition, and symbol. Therefore, the dilemma or the quarrel or the matter of the dispute might be a purely formalistic and symbolic one. But I think that such things as traditional roots and symbols in political life are very, very important. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. It was extremely interesting. And I think now we are moving to the question side of the symposium. But before we start with that, I would like to repeat myself. Repeat myself in the sense that at the beginning of the work here, I thank the organizers for what we were going to have. At the time, it was an act of faith, because I could only expect that the work would have been very interesting. Now, it's no more an act of faith, and I think that you will all agree that this symposium has been extremely interesting. Only one negative part I can say about this symposium, and it is that it's ending, unfortunately. But besides that, I only can see positive aspects to it. And so, again, I would like to thank the JFK Library for letting us stay here, and the UMass for organizing this. Particularly, I would like to thank John Hughes for all the work he did and he still has to do about this symposium. And a special thanks goes to Spencer, who has been really the soul of this symposium. He was very dedicated to this, and somehow he brought all of us into this work. We came from different parts, from far away, and now at the end we will somehow, like an explosion, move away from here like splinters, but instead of bringing death and pain, we will bring, thank God, a little more knowledge. Thank you, Spencer, and if you'd like to moderate all the questions that are going to be asked. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Roberto. You were an extremely important part of this symposium, and I would like to reiterate that the unsung hero is Jack Hughes. I would like to throw the floor open for questions, either to Senator Giugni or to other issues which these papers have given rise yesterday and the day before. Second.
Io vorrei intervenire sulle relazioni di Chubb e Carillo, anche perché è il contesto nel quale si colloca in buona parte la relazione di Giugni, soprattutto alla sua conclusione. Mi pare che giustamente Elisa Carillo abbia sottolineato che nelle relazioni manca il riferimento agli ultimi scandali. Non so se è una scelta o se è stata una questione di tempo, ma questa amputazione rende quella relazione insufficientemente motivata. Io condivido solo in parte l'ottimismo di Elisa Carrillo che si riferisce al basta dell'opinione pubblica. La condivido perché è una giusta critica all'opinione dei relatori secondo i quali scandal se constitute the norm of the public behavior in Italia, che basta Carillo ha ricordato dalla pubblica opinione, vuol dire che c'è una interruzione di questa accettazione positiva da parte degli italiani di un sistema fondato sulla corruzione. La parte che non condivido è quella costruttiva. Il basta, non basta, ci vuole qualcosa di nuovo in termini di appunto corruttivi. Gli scandali, i nomi fatti dai relatori della Chiesa, Sindona e Calvi, si dicono solo una parte della realtà italiana, perché il nome della Chiesa è legato soprattutto alla mafia, quello di Sindona a metà tra mafia e ambienti di governo, è stato fatto il nome di Andreotti, non l'ho fatto io, e quello di Calvi è piuttosto da riferire al sistema dei partiti con una forte appendice che riguarda anche la Chiesa Cattolica. Ma a mio parere la corruzione e i perversi rapporti tra politica e affari e criminalità sono, questo bisogna dirlo, ripeto, soprattutto ai nostri amici americani, il frutto avvelenato di un sistema politico che è stato dominato dalla Democrazia Cristiana. Anche se ora il Partito Socialista è il più esposto all'ondata di scandali, non solo per la quantità degli affari perversi nei quali il Partito Socialista è stato coinvolto, ma anche per un errore commesso da Craxi, il quale si è alzato in difesa del sistema, l'ha difeso con una durezza che ha fatto del Partito Socialista e di Craxi una specie di parafulmine. Lui voleva fermare i fulmini contro il sistema e è diventato il parafulmine. Tutti i fulmini si sono diretti contro il parafulmine. Ma tutto questo non deve cancellare, soprattutto in sede storica, che il sistema corrotto, insomma, quello che è stato definito dai relatori e dalla stessa Carillo, è frutto avvelenato, lo ripeto, soprattutto di un lungo predominio della Democrazia Cristiana. Il ruolo degli altri partiti è stato oggettivamente minore nel corso di questi 40, quasi 50 anni, durante i quali il sistema è nato, si è sviluppato e si è consolidato. Ora, però, questo non basta. C'è l'altro aspetto che è di grande importanza, cioè che la Democrazia Cristiana è potuta rimanere al centro del sistema nonostante essa appunto producesse tutto forse avvelenato, perché c'era il problema della difesa del comunismo. Se non ci rendiamo conto della connessione che c'è tra predominio della Democrazia Cristiana e difesa dal comunismo, lotta al comunismo, noi non comprendiamo la natura del sistema italiano. Gli scandali sono stati soffocati durante lunghi anni, perché l'insorgere degli scandali avvantaggiava il Partito Comunista, che da lunghi anni ha fatto la lotta contro i cosiddetti forchettoni. All'inizio degli anni 50 sono stati soffocati. Montanelli lanciò uno slogan che tra l'altro riprese poi da Salvini, che voleva dire: curate il naso e votate democrazia cristiana con il naso turato, perché per Montanelli, o forse non gli si può dar torto, meglio i ladri che i comunisti totalitari. Ma che tutti sapessero, e i giudici prima di tutti, che cosa che tutti sappiamo. Io voglio solo raccontarvi brevissimamente un episodio che ha fatto scalpore in Italia, ma che è rimasto appunto a livello delle battute. Quando il braccio destro di Andreotti, intorno a me, raccontò a un giornalista che un noto costruttore romano Caltagirone girava nella sede della Democrazia Cristiana con il libretto di assegni pronto a firmarla a chiunque gli chiedesse. Ed è passata nella pubblicistica italiana la battuta a Fra che perde, cioè caro amico Franco Evangelista, quanto vuoi con il libretto di assegni in mano. Ora, questa era la confezione fatta sulla stampa, di Torino la pubblica, o no, sulla Repubblica, che c'erano imprenditori che davano soldi alla Democrazia Cristiana, li pagavano, ed era il caso previsto dall'articolo 7 della legge sul finanziamento pubblico dei partiti, articolo in base al quale tanti oggi sono processati, tanti politici sono processati. E non è successo niente, non è successo niente. Perché i giudici erano inerti o insabbiavano in quanto bisognava difendere la democrazia contro il comunismo. Nel 74, nel febbraio del 74, scoppia il primo scandalo perché alcuni pretori coraggiosi, almeno in distanza, denunciano il rapporto perverso, pure semplice corruzione, tra i petrolieri e i partiti di governo. I petrolieri pagavano ai partiti di governo, pagavano i partiti di governo per ottenere leggi, non concessioni, leggi che favorissero appunto i petrolieri. Che cosa succede? Ecco, se noi teniamo conto di questi precedenti, capiamo perché oggi le cose cambiano, che se basta così. Ebbene, se non c'è stata l'alternanza in Italia, perché la gente ha votato in un certo modo, ma la gente ha votato in un certo modo perché si turava il naso e votava così. Oggi questo non c'è più, il ricatto anticomunista è finito perché il comunismo è crollato. Ed è per questo che la protesta parte dal nord, perché nel centro-nord i rapporti tra politica e affari non sono più, tra politica e contesto sociale non sono, sono fondati sul clientelismo, nel sud sono fondati sul clientelismo, nel nord no, nel nord gli intenti imprenditoriali sono economicamente autonomi, hanno votato finora soprattutto per la Democrazia Cristiana e a Milano, anche per i socialisti, perché avevano paura del comunismo. Crollato il comunismo, non solo non votano più, sembra che vogliono far pagare la Democrazia Cristiana al Partito Socialista tutto ciò che hanno dovuto subire nel passato.